Hey folks, SoCar Boy here. And there's a lot of people getting out there making all kind of great stuff on video. And the vast majority of them are using Sony Movie Studio Platinum 13. This is a tutorial on a few tricks I have learned using the movie studio products, and to introduce a few new changes in doing basic panning and annotations and transitions will be covered. So we will get started here. What you want to do, if you're halfway proficient, is select the advanced mode right here. So it's already selected. We're going to do a new project. And you'll notice that previous projects are in the queue here, but like any movie editor, files must be where they were when the project was last closed, or otherwise, of course, the computer will search your file for new locations. So we're going to fire up a new project here. Now, you see stereo and 5.1 surround. If you mean your stuff to be viewed on somebody's home entertainment system with the whiz bang package, you know, you would want to go for that. But for here, we'll just choose the stereo. And of course, you could default those settings as well. So we'll select OK. All right, we need to bring in some media now. But before we do that, let's get you introduced here. This is, of course, your timeline. It always runs from left to right. These are your tracks for both audio and video. And of course, it starts off with three here. And I believe you might be able to even default that customization for more, but we'll, you know, it's real easy to put. Add extras. And when you do when you see some of these videos with a lot of overlays, like in a road video, you will see some kind of nice sign on the screen. That is known as an overlay. And most any video editor will have a program like this that is layered. So this is your dominant, and the bottom video channel would be your layered on the bottom. But for this purpose, we're going to add, and see, this is your usually the video portion I will put in this on this line. But we're going to add some new tracks. So we right click on that and insert video track. Right click again, because you know also you can rename it. You can of course put in another one. You can duplicate the one that you already have going. You can take this one out, envelopes. There's all kind of things you can do with these tracks to customize it for your application, but for the most part, for what I do in a road video, and most everybody in this genre where this is going to be viewed is going to probably be making similar videos. So we're going to insert a video track, and we will do it again. You could, I think, do up to about 16 or so. But, you know, if you got that much, you know, you might need to invest in a pro editor. This is a nice product. It sells for about $65 for the most part. But like anything else, you have bells and whistles, and this is basically the basic current version. But anyway, we'll get started here because we got to bring in some stuff, and we're going to make us a little road video here. So we, of course, your project button, you'll be using that a lot. That, of course, it's where you would save or make changes to your, you know, you've got also video capture options here that you can explore, but we're just going to add media from this PC. So we're going to select add media. Now, I've been working on a recent series of videos from the Charlotte, North Carolina area, if any of y'all basically follow my work. And it's a good idea if you're going to be making to have folders for each of your video presentations and have an expansion drive so you don't hog up all of your storage space on your PC. So anyway, from this file, which was a recent video that was released, is where I have the raw video. So we're going to click on this and see, this is another thing I do when you download the raw video footage from your computer into your camera file, camera program, whatever you use, I always name it right then and there. And I usually like to name it from beginning to finish. And then that way I know I can keep track of to use this footage in multiple projects. Because see, this one file here is probably going to make 4 road videos total. So anyway, we will bring it in and we will bring it down to the video aisle channel there. Okay, now so version 13 here will often separate these, because see, they came, this is the raw footage and this was the raw audio captured from inside the car when the camera was running. But let's make sure it's separated. So you would select group and select remove from. Now this audio is separated from here. Now you can right click and say, whoops, bye bye. But let's see here. I think we lost all our stuff. Here's your back button. And you can undo. Of course, that only works from the last save on. But let's see. Now, I think we're good. Okay. Now, next you want to do on your video is switches. And for blur, you select disable for this type application to minimize motion blur, because it's footage shooting out of a moving automobile. So next we have to bring in some music. So from your project file, and see, you could do your same thing with your audio tracks. Now, if you start the project in 5.1 surround, you will have around 6 audio channels down here. Now, of course, you can compress the channels by this button over here, and it makes them smaller. This button here. If I get the right button, that button there makes them bigger. So anyway, we'll get started. So the first thing you do is you want to lay out your music to your video. And since that other video file is so raw, and see how far we're pulled back on the mouse, you can bring it into the timeline and roll in on your mouse for detail. You see your sound right here, and see, this is kind of your indicator how tight you're in. And see, as you roll in, and if you're splicing audio, which is what I do a lot too, you can line up your sound waves and then merge them with a crossfade. Anyway, that'll be a good start here. So we're going to trim our humongous video file here because we only need, so it's right there even with this. And what they want you to do with version 13 of this software, it used to be you can come up here to edit and split it right there, but they really have said, nah, we want you to do it this way. So you come down here to these buttons, and in normal mode, like what we're doing now, adding media and so on and so forth, is what we're going to select now. But now we're going to break this because we don't want all this. This is at least an hour's worth of raw footage. So anyway, we're going to split right there. And it did not split. We'll try this again. Now we're good. You see how the box is highlighted here? So anyway, now this button is now active, and we click that, and now this is broken into two files. And we don't need this, so we will cut that portion. And of course, if it's a mistake, you can always go, oh no, and bring it back like so. But anyway, is your last step. We don't need it. So now let's see how our music lines up. We want to roll in on our mouse for detail. Bring your pointer to 000, or wherever you want to start it. See, in this case, you know, it's four seconds and a tenth of a second. So, and then of course drag that. You can manipulate this as you want. See, now we are pan rolled back here. Would say, like, what is this? You know, so you can zoom forward. This is nothing, and so you can bring your cursor over that and right click and get rid of it. All right, now we've got our music, so we can see what we got here. You wanna, and then roll this back like so. And see, now our music's starting. And that's kind of slow, and see, we're going to vary the tempo next, so I'll show you how to do that, you know, before the band gets going here. And see, when you go through these projects, you will be doing several songs till you find the right personality for your video. So let's just say, for the sake of argument, you have your little intro here. Well, let's see where the song changes pitch. Okay, right there. All right, now what you want to do is sync your motion to the music. See, so you look here where the sound pops. See, I've zoomed in, and see, look, here's your cursor, and of course it's going to go to the right. Now here's where the tempo of the music picks up, so you can see again. Okay, so that's where we want to change our frame. So we right here, we're at that very point. See how you can roll in, and then you want to roll back like that. And then now we're going to use our split button again. So we have to highlight here. And see, I always like to bring this cursor in between that timeline pointer, and now we want to split it. Whoops, that's not what we wanted to do. That's what we wanted to do. Now, of course, we just discussed what a split is. So, right here, you look at your properties, and this is an actual speed playback rate. You can go up to 4 times. If you want to go faster, you'll have to render it and then bring it into a new project, and then you can speed it up from there. So anyway, we're gonna, when the band gets going here on this tune, cancel that. One to one. Okay, we're good to go there. And always check your work. So this is our one we want to change. Just highlight that, and we're going to go for the big kahuna and go for 4. All right, so we see what we got right here. That's how you do that. Now, we're going to put in a sign or two. So we're going to use an overlay. Okay, we're going to pan off of this sign right here. You know, we'll have to see. You know, we're not worried about what it says. So if you're a hardcore road geek, it says, oh, that sign don't match what you're doing. Get over it. This is an instruction video. So we're going to add media, and of course, however you organize your elements, and of course this would be a picture basically, and it's going to be overlaid. So we'll get a sign that kind of looks sort of like that, so this one will work. So anyway, this is our object to be overlaid. So we drag it into the timeline. This is right where we want it. And of course, there and again, you can zoom in on the timeline. So you want to right click over it, or you could, there's a shortcut button here. That's trimming. And somewhere in here is I think that's the button. Nah, I like to do, okay, that got me there, but what I like to do, to me it's so much easier, is you just bring it over, right click, and video event, pan and crop. Now, you want to, first thing you want to do with your object here, whoops, is you see this has an aspect ratio, and this, it's just been brought it in, has an aspect ratio, which may not necessarily be the same. So we first thing we want to do when we go into video event pan and crop is we want to right click over this object and match that output aspect. So now you can, the reason why you want to do that, this is an annoying thing about version 13 that I do not like, but it always wants to make that window wide and your transition window small. But anyway, it is what it is. But and of course, it, whatever your preference is on this deal, you can do like so. But just be careful though about, you could accidentally knock this window up into a toolbar and that could cause you some problems and you would have to probably reformat the program off your drive. All right, so we've got our object and we've matched our out aspect ratio. And you see this little box here, and you want to zoom in here like so with your mouse. And this defines a set of parameters. It's basically would be equal to this, what's in this preview window. So what we want to do here, we want to make this a little smaller. You can catch it right here and see, go like so. And what I like to do also, after I do that initially, you've got your buttons here, which are your position, and see, there is a F in here. This is the true center of this right here. Because like I say, this to there, that to there represents this to there and that to there. So what we want to do here is, now software can have some quirks. This little line that runs like so right here, we're going to pan this object out of that line. So we're going to, the Y is up and down, the X is right to left, the height makes smaller or larger. So we're going to make this a little bit smaller than that gargantuan size there. I know Chris Buckner will appreciate that. And he does Mid-Atlantic Roads. You ought to visit, if you're in the road videos, visit his channel sometime. anyway, we've made it the desirable size, and you can click this little monitor doolally and see this is how it will look on your screen. You hit your escape key on your PC and you can bring this, highlight this window again. So anyway, I'll show you what we did. I'm going to bring this back here. We have changed the size of this. Now you see these little diamonds here. Now these can represent, like, it'll tell you what they are. First keyframe, next keyframe, and see it's points to where you can bump this slider. I'm going to get rid of this because I want to do something different. So that's how you do get rid of that, and so it comes back to the original form. If you want to start completely over with the overlay thing, you can hit the restore button, and it's just like if you brought it in from here. So you start over, and then what you would have to do if you want to pan this object is you want to match the key frame, and that'll often make something like this larger. And there, and again, you roll back on your mouse, catch the corner, you can drag this, and this aggravating window drives me up the wall. And see, you can grab it there like so. So that's cool. So we're gonna X that, come over here, and you wanna, I like to position my stuff right there a little bit, depending on what kind of device is viewing it later on. Now, this box I was talking about earlier, which of course was this, we're going to take this out of the screen and bring it back in. And how you do that is you click there for your Y, which is your up and down. Why? Because that's what we need. And now, this is where, to avoid quirks in the software that I've experienced, now that was basically with version 11, because that's what I primarily still use, because mine has a few extra bells and whistles added to it. So anyway, and of course you can add stuff to this software as well. So, but what we're doing is we're bumping this Y button, and we want to right there. Now, I don't know if the camera is pointing out, but this little line here, which is the edge of this picture frame, your preview, which is what the finished product will show. You want this object that you're going to bring in to just touch the outside of this. There is a little sweet spot you'll see, and the reason for doing that is if you leave it up here like so, when you go to render it, sometimes it can lock up the rendering, and because the frame, it just, when this thing renders, it goes frame by frame by frame of all the stuff that's in your project, and it'll break that frame. And that's why you want to have it right here, because you will have perfect pans every time. All right, so what we want to do next is we're going to have this sign drop down. So remember these diamonds? I like to use them for a point of reference. So you can come, I like to go to the fifth diamond, and I like to line this pointer up right with the top of that diamond. Now you grab this, and you can zoom back on your mouse to see the whole shebang. Bring it down into there, and that's how you do that. So let's see how it looks on your preview. Okay, you see how that just popped off? You know, it's kind of a harsh edge, and to really have your product look nice, you want to have some kind of transition there. So you see you're in normal editing mode here. Now you want to put in a fade. Now this will be an exiting fade. You hook this, of course course, you're highlighted over this. You hook that like so. Now you can roll in for this detail. I'm pretty well rolled in now because you see this little slider here tell you how far you rolled in. When I zoom back on the mouse, and you see that window gets smaller. So actually, we probably, for the right scale, should pull that back to about right there. Now, we want to put a transition in there. And of course, we have to be in this fade mode first. Now, click your view button. And this button right here, which is window, go to that and then go down here and it will say transitions. So you click on that. And these are the standard transitions that come with the program. This is your simple curtain, there's spin, it makes it twirl, so on and so forth. What is cool to do with this is a dissolve, which is basically all you need. And since this is going away, it's a subtractive. So we click that and we drag it down into there. So now you can close this window and we can look at our result. Are you there like a stone? See, much nicer. So anyway, now, see, like if you want to bring in a second object, and we'll see whatever road this is. So I don't want nobody to squall that I got the wrong interstate number. Oh, we don't want it. See, that's where you can bring in it from a disk. But we're going to add media from the PC again. Let's see, we'll just get us something from here, from my home state. Why not? And since there's been a big squall here about a spur here in my town, which is Charleston, South Carolina. So we'll say this is 526. So we want to drag this down, and you see, now this is where I said where the program is layered. And of course, you want your annotation to be up here in the top, because that's going to be the first thing. It'll be layered over this. So, but anyway, we got to repeat the process of matching the output aspect ratio, which is this, which you'll first, you know, right click that and make this annoying window even smaller. If I can figure out how to get this joker here to default in a normal size without this super size, please leave a comment on this video. That would be cool. Anyway, this is another way to control it. See, it's your height, and see, you can hook it right there and go like so. And what we want to do here first, you want to make things look halfway realistic. So you don't want to make like your interstate shield this gargantuan thing that Hercules would hold up, you know, because nobody's going to want to see that. So to see what you got, of course, go back to your preview window, and I said that looks nice. So you hit your escape key again. And so what we're going to do here now, so we're going to make a note of this number right here, which is 3173.3. The reason why I say that, let's see here, before I tell you folks wrong, we're going to bring our to right there. Remember, this is out of the frame, because you remember with it right there, our object above is out of the frame at this point, and then at another reference point. And see, like, if you want this to occur at the same time, so you look for this reference point right here. And you remember I was telling you about, okay, when it made this mark here is when it moved to this position. So wherever point A is, which was out of the frame, and point B, which is right here, between those two points, it will move constantly. Now, like what I'll do is I'll bring an object in and leave it there, and as this goes along there, I'll get it to a certain point because I want the object to stay in this point through most of its travel, and I'll bump that line, that slider line, just to make a diamond, and that will hold this in place. And then if you want to shoot real quick off to the frame, then or you can apply a dissolve, whatever you want to do. It's so anyway, you can always recheck. All right, see, we just matched our aspect ratio. And you can roll back on your mouse, of course, and drag this corner or use this over here. You can even finish up with that. And see, as you make the object smaller, and of course, also, you see how your pointer is right here at the beginning, which is where you want it when you introduce a new object. And this is right here at the same point. So, because the reason why is, all right, we're going to get rid of this. See that diamond there I was talking about? When you move an object, it makes that diamond. So you get rid of that. Okay, now, 2747.4. Now, if you have a bunch of equations, you can write them down, but let's just say, okay, so we're small there, and so we can drag this to a certain point, and you see how when it pulled the frame, it advanced the picture, and this was already panned, so that dropped down. So at this point, we can even type in that number, 2747.4. And as soon as I move this cursor, boom, you see that little diamond that popped up? So now you can go back here. And then, of course, you don't want that 526 or whatever you pan there to jump off. So you can put that to there. And we still were selected on fade. If not, you select fade. You highlight this object. And there and again, I like to bring the cursor to there. Now this object is highlighted. And since it's already on fade, you hook that corner. And I like to bring them to the same point. Hit view. Window, transitions, dissolve, and a subtractive dissolve again. And are you there like a star? And that's how that is done. Now, we're going to put an annotation in here. So, how you do that, I want to first pull back on this mouse a little bit. And I want to bring it cursor to right there. That'll be good. And, but you can always move it around. But we're going to put an annotation in here. View again, window. And see, this window has a lot of your basic controls. And I don't know, you know, I wish they would have just left those controls in here. But there and again, it is what it is. But window. Media generators. All right, what I like to do, and of course, once you click that and anything, I like to come down here to, since we're just going to type in text, to legacy. And I just like to use the default text, which is this. And of course, what it will do here is it will initially display and whatever, in here in this case, Arial font. It will always start off at 72 font height. And of course, you can bold or whatever, and then whatever fonts are on your PC, like a lot of the road videographers use the Road Geek, but you can that's used online, and you see how the font changed. But anyway, we'll just go back to Arial for a notation if I can find it. And there it is, you know, so we're back to our original. So what we want to do now, like this, you can customize, you want to make that a color, you click on properties and you can click it here, or you could type in your own formula. I know a good formula that is a red, and it looks a lot like what Christopher Owens does. You can visit his channel, which is the Solar Catcher. So we'll call this Christopher Owens Red. You know, so if you have these little formulas, so you see how it's turned red. All right, so you want to put a little outline in there to make it pop. Now it starts off with yellow, it's what it's always, but if you want some other color, let's say you want to go hot fuchsia pink, you know, if that floats your boat. Yes, you see, or you can do it again, you can type in the color code. If you move these all the way over here, these three sliders, see, you're at black. If you move them all the way back to the right, you're at white. And I think in this case, white would look good. But there and again, whatever your preference is for what you're doing. And see, now we're white. And of course, any color that you can imagine is in between. Now you grab this width slider and you see you can make it super gargantuan outline. But I like to line these two. This is a feather adjustment, which is, you know, really doesn't do a whole lot, but it's, of course, you click on draw outline, and this is in your effects tab. Again, and see your properties, this shows you your color selections, and your background color is none, because you see here, this represents total transparency, because if you had this selected, brought up, if you brought that number down, then your video here would it actually fade away, you know, because this would dominate over it. But anyway, we're looking good there, so we want to bring our height down. Usually I like to do 12 point. Now I have played around with this through the years of doing these, and alright, typed in for the sake, come on, this is the best damn annotation ever, okay, that's what I, so you escape, and of course, what it's always going to do, if that's a little bit too small, and you want to get back to it, see, this is another thing that's good about the program, but I'm sure most any video editor would have this feature. You can usually want your annotation up on your top line, which is text. And this is maybe a little bit small. So you want to get back to that, and I always like to right-click over this object. To me, it's the easiest. Edit media. We're going to make our font 28. Why not? There we go. Now, there and again, for detail, you can zoom in or out with your mouse in the timeline, but this has to be flashing for the mouse to zoom in or out. So you're going to, it always, no matter what, when you put in an annotation, it's always going to center it in the screen like so. If you want to have it down there, you can And you bring your pointer. This is an important thing of starting your vents here, or you can, I dragged it back. But we can actually show a movement here if you want to. So you would pan and crop and make annoying window smaller. And what you can do here, if you want it to, we're going to do a fancy one here. So what we want to do is we want this to get bigger from here down to here. So how you would do that is poke your Y, come up to there. Now, you can do a multiple movement. So we want to make this smaller. So there and again, see, you have to adjust. So that's why you set your starting point. Okay, because as you know, the position changes when the height changes. So, okay, we start that. All right, we hit our slider, and we can come to right here, which is cool. There and again, using our diamonds as a reference point or whatever floats your boat. So hook it again. We're going to come down, pull in the Y. Why? Because that's what you need to do. Now, you want to come up here to height, and you're going to pull down. And see how? And then you have to compensate with the Y. Bring it up. And that's why I like to do this, and you'll see why I do this. And then now you can pull it down. To wherever you want it. And then you can see what your labors have won. Then, you know, if you really want to get fancy, okay, we want this a little bit longer, so you have to click on normal. So remember these control buttons down here. So once you click on normal, you want this all to happen. So now you've just stretched this object, but you can make it. So now when you go back into here, these reference points have changed now. And see, you can actually alter things. You see how I'm grabbed this slider here? You know, you can bring it back to where you started from, which is at the beginning, which as you see is right there. And there's the point where the first diamond was a movement, and then there's that. And let's say we want this to zip on out of there. So what you do is see, you get your Y, and the down button is your movement to the right. The up button in the X, excuse me, the X is your left and right. Your down would be to the right. Your up would be to the left. So we're going to be going to, so just bump that one time. And what I've done here is see, it's put that as soon as it senses movement of any keystroke or whatever, it's going to put a diamond as a point of reference there. So you can go back to there, and then let's say you want it to go to get out the movement to be right there. So what you will do, pull back so you can see your whole window. And there and again, this box right here is going to be this. So, and anything I like to, you see, I went down on that X. Now, there and again, as I was talking about the other object, this is the edge of that object. Of your feet, this is the edge of that object, the annotation. This is the edge right here. So you want to just with your up button bump the X to bring that over. And you'll see there's a little sweet spot where it will just blink. You know, the color will change at that. There, right there. That line goes away. It's basically what happens. So now we can see what we have. And that's how that's done. So there we have covered, and like I say, to these elements that you'll see in your timeline, and see, and like I say, it's all layered there. And let's say this is everything you need, and let's say you want to, let's say that this song ends right here. So you don't want any more of this tune. You know, as that's moving along. And see, for your point of reference, see, we were way back here. So let's say we want our tune to change after all this action. So we come back up and see, like I say, there's your layers. Here's your top with your annotation and so on and so forth. And we're coming back down to our music, and see, this each track is labeled, and of course that's one of your, so you bring the cursor over that pointer, and then now you've got this box highlighted, which is your song. So let's say, see, now by zooming in on your mouse, you see how this sound wave changes. This is almost like an electronic oscilloscope. So if you want to, first you split the frame, if you don't want any more of this, you cut that just like you would video. And let's say you want to bring in another element, add media, and of course you got to go to your music file on your, wherever you store your music. And yeah, some libraries, but we'll see how Aaron, we can actually mix Aaron Tip, you know, that'll be, why not? I like to use different genres of music to appeal to mass audience. So anyway, of course, this is just an example for, it's this is where country would meet alternative rock, grunge rock from Seattle. So now what you can do, let's say you want to match some frequencies, so you zoom in on your mouse and you want to put in a fade envelope, so you click your fade, you draw that in like so. Go back to normal, and let's see here, you want some sound event to occur. Okay, you see where this spikes. So what you can do is you look at your height of your sound. We can bring it in like there. And what's good to do is when you're moving, bring the pointer to the edge, and that way it'll act like a wall to keep it where you want it to come down. So you left click that and drag it down. And let's see how this makes a crossfade. And of course, the parameters of the preferences it defaults to do an automatic crossfade, but that's what that is a crossfade. And see, there's the change in your sound. So that's just a few little tricks. And of course, if, let's say, then of course, if you want to shorten the project to right here, you want to split everything and highlight the object. Hit your split. And you put in a fade. Alright, then you bring your cursor back to there. Click normal again. Come up here. And now we're lined up. You see where this is? Alright, we want the video to end at the same point. So you highlight that, and there and again you split. And we put in our fade. And what you can do is come back and see where this one is. Use that as a point of reference. And come up and draw your fade. And you're lined up perfectly. And see, this will be your end. And that's how that's done. I hope you've enjoyed this. That's some tricks that I've learned with the program. It's however you're comfortable using it. Does have options for use, but I like to use, again, for the basic controls, you go to View, Window, and you can do your transitions, which of course you have to put in a fade, and then you drop your transition into there. Media generators, when you want to add an annotation or a background, that's also in there. Let's say you want to have a nice background. I've used that a few times. But anyway, that's where you get to all that stuff, you know, window and so media, project, add media, pull it in off your PC. But we're still untitled here, so we have to save, and you can do saves along the way. And when I'm doing a project that has a lot of stuff in it, I like to do baby saves along the way, and that way, if there's a power failure, one time that happened to me, I had a whole bunch of stuff, and there was a power failure, and boop, bye-bye. But if you're saved, that won't happen. But we're going to save, and we're going to have, we'll call it Vegas Tutorial. And of course Vegas was, they used to call it Sony Vegas. And we'll save our project like so. So now we want to render this project. So you come back to here. And like I say, before you save, you want, before you render, that is, you want to pull back on your mouse and look at everything to make sure you don't have no little straggler hanging back out here. And see how this has gotten so small when when you zoom in, there's your detail. So everything looks good. Bring your pointer back to zero. Make a movie. And you've got options here. You can burn it to a disk. You can save it to a camera or something else. You can upload it to Facebook or YouTube, but I don't know if that might be the wisest thing. But you save it to your drive. Of course, you have your traditional Windows media file. You got MP4 formats and AV, CHD, however. We'll just do the traditional WMV. And it's rendering now. And you see that little preview window going as it renders. And it should render this quick because it's a very short file. Usually an 8-minute video, 8 to 10 minute video, depending on your PC, will take around an hour or so to render. Mine does it around 45 minutes because you want as fast a microprocessor as possible, because usually these type of programs, whether they the other products that are out there, I can't really think of them at the moment, but there are some other fine products out there for video editing as well. Because I know TJ Hansel, he's got his channel called American Roads. He uses another fine product. I think it's called Power Director, and that's another nice one. But of course, maybe he'll give us a tutorial on that one day. But anyway, we're rendering along, and you see we're almost a third of the way done. And of course, as this process, and of course, then you will have your completed file. So anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope I've been a benefit to y'all, to where maybe you could pick up on something. And like I say, have fun editing, and I'll see you on YouTube. Take care. Bye.